Form, I'm sorry. There, you know, air conditioning, even though we need it in here. Welcome, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for coming. It's a great pleasure to see you here. This is a very informal meeting for us. Where's Martin? We're missing somebody. Talk to our ticket taker. Okay, Martin.
That's not her.
Yeah, that's my chair, so he doesn't dare sit in it. The authority figure here. So, most of you know me. Not everybody. I'm Joya. Let's see, what do I want to say? Who are you? I was just about to say that. Marcia, Craig, Owen, and Martin. All coming from various vantage points in improvisation. So everybody knows this is improvisation. I'm emphasizing that because Craig recently did a solo and somebody who saw it a few months later came up to him and said, oh, I saw you do your oral interpretation. But it was a story he made up and it was so well done she assumed it was oral interpretation, meaning it's a spoken piece that you interpret. So anyway, blah, blah, blah. So yes, so everything is improvised. We don't know what we're going to do. We don't know what we're doing. A lot of the time, but that's why we do it, because we really like not knowing what's coming next, just knowing where we've come from and not where we're going. So I call my work full spectrum improvisation because it includes the whole spectrum of emotion, as in theater, to differentiate it from comedy improv, which stays with the light side. We may be funny, we may not be funny for a moment. It's not our agenda to determine that. To go there or not go there. That's not what's happening. We're trying to deal with whatever's coming up. We're trying to help our genie. There's room there. Yeah. Is Danny with you?
Yeah.
Okay, great. You go around and come around the front here. we're trying to just honor what's coming up for us for a moment because we want the work to mean something to us. Owen calls his work inside out in improv. Danny, there's a chair. If you want to sit next to Jeannie, where is she? You okay there?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. And Owen's work is much more physical, and he's younger, so it's more physical than me. And we've been working together a year, year and a half or something, and working with Craig for many years, and the same with Martin and Marcia. So we're all trying to blend. Owen and I are, you know, how can we make our styles or allow our styles to enrich each other. That's what we're working on, and so far it's going nicely. Just that's about it. Anything I forgot?
Just that we've been, this configuration has been sort of working, what, roughly a year and a half or 2 years?
Marcia's new work.
Marcia's new work. So, we wanted to, we have a regular practice, we want to open that up for you to see what we've been up to as we kind of bring it up.
So this will look very much like a practice. As improvisation always does look like a practice. So we do have a sense of who's going to go first, because that's all of that, and a little bit of a sense of the order, but at a certain point we don't know who's getting up when, and people will get up according to the actors will get up according to their impulses, and we'll see what happens. It's all kind of wide open. Sometimes we work with props, sometimes we work with music. We're not doing any of that tonight. It's very pared down. So unless somebody has a question, without further ado,
thank you for coming.
Thank you for coming. out of place, new place, old place. Floor gets quick, the floor gets crap.
It's just a rental, isn't it?
This is a rental, and she is. She's a rent, you know.
Yeah.
She was out in a minute, she loved to have cars to get us out. Scraping the floor with a funny chair. So, thank you for not doing that.
Thank you for appreciating. I mean, thank you for extending that to me. I feel like, in the whole moving process, we kind of lost touch with our humanity a little bit. You know, in all of the changes, in all of the, in all of the tumult.
Yeah, the tumult, and the tumultuous.
Yes.
Yes, yes. It's good to have a solid place to rest.
At least one.
Settle down, you know, because it is so easy for us to, you know, to go off. I mean, that's normal. I'm not saying it's normal. Not saying that.
She gets anxious in new places. That's why we bring a chair. We need something familiar. Something that she knows. Now, she got this chair at a job that she hated. It was a horrendous, horrendous job where she was doing bookkeeping for a small startup. And when she left, all they gave her was this chair. No severance pay or anything. And she felt so resentful that she had put in 5 years with it and just tossed her out. But she's a pragmatic woman.
I got a chair. I didn't have to pay for it. But I had to carry it home. On the mini. I didn't have a car. Wouldn't have fit anywhere. They gave it to me with this graciousness, like, aren't we generous employers? He was very understanding. He's really always understanding. He talks about humanity. And then I feel guilty because I have a temper, you know, and he hardly ever does. He's always kind of, chilled out. And I don't know if it's all the dope he smokes or what, but it doesn't work for me, though. I just get paranoid. It just doesn't work for me.
I like this place.
You like this place?
It's gonna work out, yeah.
You like it already, man? I think you've been living here 6 hours.
You know, San Francisco was getting old.
You like
everything
it?
Was so cramped. There were so many people.
I know. It's so dense now. Did you know it's the second densest city in the country after New York, San Francisco? No place to go, you know? You can't see this water all around us. And we have to consider ourselves lucky to have a place to live.
I do. I'm serious, I'm honest. I'm being honest about that. I do. I do consider myself lucky. Actually, this is my lucky shirt. I wore it today because it's my lucky shirt. And I wanted you to know that I mean, yes, that's right. Because I felt like on our moving day, we need everything working for us. Because, I mean, it's an issue. There's always like, you know, even though it's just like you have a lot of furniture, things can go wrong.
No, I know
it happens.
It always happens. I expect there to be mold in the walls here. I expect that the windows are pent and shut. That's what. Is that what you meant?
I was thinking about a relationship. The stress would start to wear on you. You start to have your meltdowns. You start clawing at the floor like you do like an animal. You start going up. I was afraid that if we didn't have the deck stacked in our favor, things could start to fall apart like in our last apartment. Do you remember?
I just had an apartment. There was something about it.
Black Box Theater, remember? You wanted to be able to have a place where you could work. You wanted a place where you could work, you had to go out and rent space all the time. That was the whole point. It was rent.
It doesn't mean it had to be so funky. I mean, just because we were doing theater doesn't mean we had to be so poor all the time. Funky. Do we? Do we?
Do we? Not now.
No.
Not anymore.
Yeah, good job.
Not anymore.
Yeah.
And we're in the valley.
You really can tell you've got a good job.
Yeah.
You can tell just look at you.
Yeah.
Just
you know
look at him.
I bought lucky pants too.
These pants are short. These pants are like stretch a little.
Watch
like
this.
Spandex. I think they look really handsome on me. And the shirt, is that something?
Yeah, it's silk. We got into that before, okay? Can we just leave that? The whole silk worm thing? I don't want to do that. I feel bad about it, right? It's okay. It's okay. Okay, you know? I'll stick to synthetics.
No. That's petroleum. You know, you don't want to wear petroleum. This is rayon.
I'll just use hemp.
Hemp.
Yeah. Organic grown hemp.
Right.
Locally sourced.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, okay,
yes.
It's fine.
Right, from your pot.
From the plantation. This place is going to be fabulous. We're going to have plants hanging from the ceiling. Dry. We're going to start making textiles.
And those great chocolate chip hot cookies that you used to make.
Remember those?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they used to make them.
I used to be able to eat it before the crawling and the floor came. Something changed in the brain chemistry, the way things change when you get older, even if you don't want them to. Want the chair? Would you like the chair?
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Are you gonna suck my blood?
No. Because it just turns out that before
planter warts. But there's nowhere for them to live. He felt sorry for those little creatures, the creepy crawlies. He wanted a place for them to live and be happy. So think of that next time you're scraping your toe with a shredder. You're destroying the native habitat of God's beloved parasites.
I feel no guilt for destroying them. I have to keep my feet pristine.
That's what this is about. That's what this is about. Territory.
That's right.
Lines in the sand.
Yes. And nobody is going to inflict me with their bad mojo. Me too.
It's not easy being a parasite. It's not easy living off of the life force of others. A lot of people look down on you and think, what is that thing growing on me? Why is there hanging on, hovering just outside of range of conversation, awkwardly holding its drink? That's me.
Told you. Don't get too close.
You don't know what I'm gonna do if you get too close.
Can you work this out? Can you, can I be the perfect host for you somehow? Maybe if I don't know, sweeten the deal, you know? Maybe we can work on a schedule of some sort. You know, I don't have somewhere to be, somewhere to go, and somewhere to, you know, entertain or something, but maybe...
You know, if you really don't like me, you can always go barefoot in the gym shower and give me someone else. If that's what you want, we'll always have the elliptical.
Thank you.
I've lost everything. I've lost everything that I ever had. My clothes, my bed, my diary, things in the refrigerator. My house burned. The third floor plane framed my bed. My stuff, all my stuff, it was filled with smoke. Smoke and charred stuff. And the fucking landlord, he told me to get out. I should have just told him to jump up my ass. Because rumor had it that he burnt the building. It was the first wave of dot com and he wanted us out. And I didn't want to come here and talk about him or all of that stuff, but it's he didn't set the building on fire. But my stuff was everywhere. People's garages. The first floor of your apartment, I asked if I could put my old chest in drawers. It was scattered throughout San Francisco. I didn't want anything. I just wanted a bowl to walk up and down the street and beg for ice. I never wanted to have anything ever again. I didn't want to have the burden of having things. So the landlord bought me out for $20,000. And I bought a studio at 24th and Paterno. And I had been living in Lower Pacific Heights, excuse me, for a long time. So there were trees and nice weather and it was all very white and middle class. And when I moved to 24th and Paterno, the first night I went out, and it was still Little Guatemala. People were speaking Spanish, were people of color. And until 11 o'clock at night, I was walking away from the bar, and I was afraid of the stories that I had read that there would be a drive-by shooting. I would be shot. And every, I'm not proud of this. I'm not proud of this, that every racist bone in that first 24 hours of the mission lit up. My studio was 450 square feet. When you walked in, here it was, and it was all white. A white carpet and white walls. And I could see the east wing and the west wing and the bowling alley and the swimming pool just by standing in my studio. And then come from a three-bedroom flat, so it was a change. It was so small, and it was mine. And if anybody worked in town, it would be me. And I slept on a pallet, because I still had the monk fantasy. I slept on a pallet in the corner, and I had no furniture. And a friend came over, a pushy redhead from New York, and she didn't like my place. She said that it was sterile. She said it had no character. She wanted to put cut-up material over the lights. She wanted to go with me to buy a sofa, my first piece of furniture. I still didn't want any furniture at this time, but right there, in the middle of the furniture store, was this amazing royal blue sofa. And it was like a throne. It had a collar. It just had this big collar like a king or a queen. And it was stunning. It looked like it should have been in a cartoon. And it was like, oh my God, this is going to be my first piece of furniture. I was so excited. $879. I put it on the west wing of the studio. And it just stood there in all its regalness. Did I say that it was royal blue? And on the second night, I was dating a young man, and we were the same size. Can you believe that? We had the same size hand, we were the same height, we had the same legs. It was a match. It was a match made in heaven, I thought. And it was sound. I could feel the sofa coming alive, if you will. I know that sounds funny. I come all the way over here and tell you about a sofa that's starting to talk to me. And you've heard the story, you've heard cars that talk, but anyway, I could feel my sofa, the royal blue sofa. It was talking to me. It was telling me to move on. It was telling me to kiss the man and get a life and start to live again. So I had my first gathering. I invited anyone of my best friends for brunch to see the royal blue sofa. I secretly named him Eddie. I don't know why. Eddie. Sometimes I would just say Ed. And they came in one at a time. And they made egg dishes and cheese dishes, you know, brunch. And there was a part of me that had married a lesbian from Trinidad to keep her here for political purposes. And she walked in with her new lover. I never met her. And she had a wide brimmed hat. And she was regal. And she walked around the studio and we met and everything was grand. We were having a great time. And we were frying eggs and there was guacamole. And Susan, with her royal big hat, had a couple of fried eggs and guacamole. And she was coming to the royal, so the royal laughed and talking, and she dropped! And she fell and smashed her plate.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, God. I didn't want to show. You know, certain situations instead of freaking out, I'm doing the opposite. It's nothing. It's just a blue sofa. We can wash it. We have water, we have bags. With guacamole. Together. On my blue sofa. It doesn't matter at all. And I looked at her. Faking it. Faking it till the cows came home. So the boyfriend, he comes back, and he has an old dog, and I love the old dog, and I was just getting to know this man. He was a little neurotic, not like me, in a different way. And you know, in the beginning, you don't even know who they are. You're just kissing. And then the old dog climbs up on my sofa. I can't see. So, you know, in the law of attraction, in the land of the law of attraction, are you thinking things? Is this going to happen? Are you drawing it to you? But the old dog just kind of rolled off my sofa. It had peed! It had peed! It had life kind of went on. You know how it does. You just kind of move on, you just stand up, because you gotta go to work. No matter if your house burned, they don't give a shit if your house burned. I'm getting carried away. So one day, my beautiful white apartment, I'm doing yoga. And I'm stretching, looking at the wall, blue sofa. What? Guacamole stain, and the pee stain, and I am beyond it. I am just stretching and loving it. I'm just stretching out my what? I'm just stretching. I'm just stretching, and I see a little bug. I see a little bug in the white carpet, and I didn't make anything of it. And then. There's another bug crawling on my head. And I take it off, and it's the same bug, or it's the cousin of the bug that was when I was doing yoga on my white. I'm forgetting the word carpet. I was doing yoga on the carpet, and I don't know why, ladies and gentlemen. I go right to the ear. And I go to my house. It's a wall bed. I run to the wall bed. And
ink, and I bring the Wobbit down, and if you don't pull the Wobbit down, it goes back up. So I get the Wobbit and bring it down, and my foot here, and pick the mattress up. It's 15 years later. My sweat and your sweat and their sweat is on my royal blue sofa. The edges are worn down. I can see where I've sat for 1,000,000 hours. I need to throw oil blue regal. I'm procrastinating. But when I get into it, I have a big old magazine of sofas. And I'm going to look at them.
Thank you.
cheer with me. I apologize in advance for that attachment, but I do seem to have a need for furniture. Like my friend Craig, and my other friend, in your case,
it's okay.
It's fine.
This time.
Bring it in. Closer.
I'm dragging it really lightly so as not to hurt the dance floor.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Would you?
Yes.
Hear?
Of course. Absolutely. Wow, you just have such an accepting attitude towards my.
Well, some people have called it a compulsion, but you know, that's just words, you know. Judgmental words.
No,
we don't judge you. Oh, we're happy to have you.
Oh.
We accept you.
Absolutely. Really?
Mm-hmm.
Well, this. Wow. It is a rather nice place you have. I like the courtyard very much. Mm-hmm. With all those plants and pots out there.
You want to rest?
Why should I have to rest?
I just thought you might be tired.
You're trying to be nice to me.
Yes, absolutely.
Please. Sit down.
We have a lovely chair for you.
That's my chair. Isn't it? I bought that chair. And now they're acting like they.
We just received this chair here today, and we love for you to sit.
It's our reality is clashing. That's what happens, you know. What's true for me is not necessarily true for you. I don't tend to like to sit down.
Would you like to use that?
See color? How I'm standing up straight? I just opened my chest. The sternum is coming forward. I knew that. I used to take dance classes. They said, lift the sternum and let the shoulder blades drop down the back. And that. Pardon me?
Oh.
Did
for you.
Oh. Did you say your name is?
Kevin.
Look, so familiar, Kevin. You look like a relative of mine.
I could be related.
I think so. You could be.
I is she sitting down?
I think so. Because last time I saw you, you were going to look for a job, and then you didn't let me know where you were working or if you found a job or anything like that. Oh.
Oh, I self-expression. I remember when you were just a young kid. I remember it. You were always shy in school. And the teacher would write notes to me. She would say, Kevin doesn't speak up when he's gone.
We're working on that. Together. We're trying to work on that together, but I'm not a very good teacher.
I'm so happy to caught up with you. I didn't know where you went, and I was very worried about you. It caused me a lot of trouble and anxiety. But I've had anxiety in a previous piece, so maybe I shouldn't have it.
Oh, you're talking about time and peace and place.
It's so easy for everyone else. They just open their mouths and they can just let it all out, let all their emotions out.
don't know what we're doing at the moment. We usually don't. Getting up by yourself?
Yeah.
Oh.
This next piece is not going to involve any furniture. It might be a chair, any reference to furniture. It's not going to involve spaces or moving other places. We're not going to talk about embroidery. We're not going to talk about messes that happen on embroidery or upholstery. We're just going to live off of that bill. I mean, not that it's a bad thing to have. I mean, furniture is something that everybody's involved with. Like, it's part of our home. It's familiar to us. And when you come home alone, it's something that is always there. But it's not really what's important, and I'm not going to talk about it anymore. So I apologize for going on. Solitary confinement for 2 years, and I wondered myself, what is that like? It's just you and your brain. At first you feel like maybe this is going to be like a Zen retreat. It's going to be a test of my ability just to let it all go. Just to let everything go. I can do this. I can turn this into a spiritual awakening. I can do this. And after a week, you feel good, like this is working. I'm dropping down, I'm feeling that I am one with everything in this prison. I'm one with it, I can be okay, I can make this work for me. After a month,
explode from all sides. Like a pomegranate under pressure, and the seeds spray out on the walls, and they're dripping on the walls, a deep magenta, except it's not flesh, it's your mind, and it's dripping down the walls, and you're not even thinking anymore, am I okay, or am I not okay, it's just you. On the walls. After a while of being in solitary confinement, there's nothing you can do. You have no power. So the only thing you can do is take apart your own body, your own mind. That's the only thing you can do. It's the only power you have, is to rip your own flesh. And that's what he did. He just started to rip his own flesh, to take it off. And would ooze under the doors, puddles of flesh, until the guards came. The guards came, and they'd seen it before, and they'd open the door, and he'd be waiting. I met him last week. He was doing much better. He got involved in the arts. He was doing a play. And he was starting to bond with other prisoners. And he wasn't near as upset. And he had pulled himself back together again and tied it up. And he created a container for himself. I want to talk with him. I was visiting him as an artist. Looking at the production that he created with his fellow prisoners, all people who were there for life who would never get out. That was it. And he told me about growing up in a neighborhood that was full of violence, guns, and drugs. And when he was 6 years old, when he was 6 years old, he found a gun. This is what he told me, I don't know what actually happened. And he took it out with him with his friends, and he started playing with the gun, and he started shooting off the gun, and he got picked up by the police. He was only 6 years old. Couldn't take him in. But his mother, who was a Jehovah's Witness, who knew about sinners and saints. She was a good woman who had a job at a company in IAE where they made software for businesses. She worked hard and she brought him, even when he was young, she brought him to Disneyland. She went to take him across the ocean again to Disneyland. But she kicked him out. Instead, he went to live with his father, who was a heroin addict. He said to me, when he was there, all he could remember was smoke. It was just full of smoke. Everybody was smoking all the time. Like a cloud, like living in a cloud of smoke. He stayed there until he was 12, and again he was caught for having a gun. He was sent, this time, to a detention center.
the prison where I met him. When I was 13, I grew up in a suburb of Boston, a nice suburb. And I was caught selling hash to my fellow eighth graders, at 13. Before that, I was suspended for 3 weeks from school. I made to have a talk with the chief of police, a heart-to-heart. He was a friend of the lawyer that my father had hired for me. And as a result, my parents thought that maybe they weren't giving me enough attention, which was true. And so my father took me with him to work once a day. He pulled me out of the eighth grade. Once a day, every Wednesday, we went to work. He was a neuroscientist at Harvard Medical School. And I don't remember much, except he'd get candy in the drawers. We used to have soda and sandwiches at lunch. And his colleagues would talk about lectures. And one of them talked about an expedition he took to K2, the second highest peak in the Himalayas. And then I went on to a private school because I was concerned that my reputation would precede me in the public high school. And that led to a chain of educational events that led me to college and art school, into becoming an artist, and to find my way as a visiting artist into that prison.
Solar energy.
I'm sorry.
Solar energy.
Solar energy and caviar. Any more?
Irresistible.
Quantum physics. Sorry, again?
Quantum physics.
Still again.
Quantum physics.
Quantum, Jesus. Quantum physics. What else?
Irresistible.
Irresistible, what?
Whatever you want.
Something irresistible. All right, irresistible quantum physics and caviar. So let's pick something out of that. Irresistible. What else was there?
Solar energy.
Solar energy, the sun. Irresistible. All right. Well, I asked for it, so I guess I'll have to start. You know, all these stories that have gone before with furniture and home and bugs and cages triggers all kinds of memories for me. I have this problem that I get flooded with impulses. I have about 8 stories I'd like to tell you all at the same time, but I'm going to have to pick one. And that's why I needed you guys. And the irresistible part is really coming over me. I'm thinking of my first husband. First husband. And I have a second husband. The second husband had lasted a very long time. The first husband was, a starter marriage. Yes, I met him when I was 19, maybe 18 years
old. Marriage. The first time was when I was 4. I remember the leaves, mostly. The leaves falling down around us. And our eyes were locked. And our lips touched. And she said, "Ew." "You taste like apple candy." And I knew at that moment that it would last forever.
Well, Michael, my first husband, was really cute. He was kind of an all-American guy. He was 6'3" and very waspy. I'm Jewish. And that was part of the deal there, right? Was that my parents, of course, didn't want me to marry a waspy guy and a guy who was studying to be a social worker. They wanted a Jewish doctor or something like that. And they didn't really want me to get married at all because I was 19 years old. But of course, that was part of the deal for me. If they didn't want it, I did. Ooh, I would say, ooh. Didn't say they suggested, ooh, yuck.
So I'm engaged, and it's my first time. So it's even a pre-marriage type of commitment. And he's really great because he likes to buy me champagne. Even when we're going out to just any regular restaurant, and they always ask us, "Are you celebrating something?" Life, we say. We're celebrating life together. And so he took me out for a birthday dinner, and I got to choose the restaurant. And I chose a bottle of wine. They didn't have it, damn one. But I wanted it with my oysters as well. And I think I'm getting a little, how should I say, accustomed to being pampered, right? With champagne and oysters.
I wasn't accustomed to being in other people's houses. Their house was special. They had solar panels in the 90s. Who has solar panels in the 90s? Seriously. She did. And everything was so special. Everything was different. We didn't get out of much.
He was really different. He's really different from me. He's from the East Coast, and
and my first boyfriend, before Michael, the guy I married at 19, my very first boyfriend, the one to whom I gave my virginity, which back then was some kind of valuable commodity. He was from East Palo Alto. You may not know what East Palo Alto means, but it means working class. It's definitely not Jewish.
Yeah, I'm not working. Well, I have a temporary job at this time, and I actually have more money in my bank account than I've ever had in my life.
Life went on. The years went on. And I think she forgot about our marriage in the woods. But I remembered.
Would you like to take a lift? I mean, I'll pay, you know, because I mean, I have money in the bank.
And so the first guy that I just mentioned, his name was Johnny Wyckoff. And he gave me a lift on what, can you guess? A motorcycle!
I mean, I even bought a scooter, you know? I mean, I have one of those things that I go around San Francisco just scooting.
Just riding around in his black leather jacket, of course.
And she had black, short hair in the fourth grade. Who has that? Short hair in the fourth grade, girl, no one. But she did. And she had a voice like an angel.
And she must have been looking down on me to find someone that matches me so well.
I had to find someone that was different than everyone else, you know. He's a rebel and he never does what he should.
Some say love is like a fountain. In the assembly, she sang for everyone.
What is love?
My wife.
Baby, don't hurt me.
Just because he doesn't do what everybody else does, that's no reason why I can't give him all my love.
No.
four.
But something more happened. In the sixth grade, something happened in class.
And I said to myself afterwards, is that all there is?
Is this it? Are you the one?
But I figured the answer was, yeah.
Yeah.
This is all there is.
Intensify. So, thank you so much.
Thank you for joining us.